Hey buddies, here we are on the, technically the first day of E3 today. Today is Tuesday. Technically E3 doesn't start till today. Even though all the press conferences are on Monday, E3 is technically Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And Nintendo continues to stubbornly have their press conference the next morning instead of on Monday with everybody else, which is kind of annoying, but whatever. I'm excited anyways. I'm excited to see what they have to show us. Rumor has it that we're gonna see a new IP from the man himself, Shigeru Miyamoto? Beautiful French name. And that we're going to see some new Smash Bros. Content, hopefully some new challengers, hopefully a trailer, a CG trailer, maybe something. I have this feeling, do you guys have this feeling that the little bit that we saw that introduced Charizard as a competitor was possibly just like a little snippet of a full-length CG trailer that they have or something like that? It's supposed to start at 9 a.m., but as we can see there, despite it saying 9 a.m. start time, and despite my clock saying that it is now 8:38, Nintendo's math pegs that at approximately 47 minutes away. I'm not sure how that works, but maybe Japanese tell time differently. Forty-seven minutes is the length of the show? Oh, okay, thank you. Only 47 minutes long, huh? So, yesterday was Sony's press conference. At this stage, it is my opinion that Sony has by far taken the E3 press conference competition, if it's to be a competition. In my mind, it is, every year. We decide who is the winner. It's a fun thing to do. Right now, Sony is winning by a long shot. Microsoft did a decent job, but nowhere near as good as Sony. Ubisoft continues to show a lot of heart, and they make us love them every year because they actually come on stage with personality, and they look more relaxed and more natural than most of the other companies, and we appreciate that, but it still didn't. Ubisoft won 2 years ago, and came maybe even close to, well, they didn't beat Sony last year, but Ubisoft did a great job too. But Sony, by far, holy shit. Sony was really bogged down by TV shite, says Nuclear Air. Not at all, no. They spent about 10 minutes on a comic book that they're turning into a free television series for PlayStation Plus subscribers, so that is very relevant to their gaming system, to their gaming subscription service. After that, that was pretty much it, and people are upset by that. In fact, it looks like they've had to even disable comments and ratings on that video because backlash is so hard. It's funny that their press conference was longer than any of the other ones, by about an hour's length, and yet a 10-minute snippet in the middle makes it so that you have to deduct points somehow from the entire thing that you didn't like completely. That's silly. They didn't spend too much time talking about Business Munchie. They spent hardly any time talking about the business. They talked about their service. They talked about their upcoming products. They just talked about aspects of all of those things that you weren't particularly interested in. And the whole point of them talking about it was the hope that you would become interested in it because you hear them talk about it. That's the whole point. Why do you think they showed it to you? Was hoping that you would become interested in what they're talking about. Even I'll admit, during the comic book part, whatever it was called, Powers, I was a little bit bored by it. It wasn't the most exciting part of the conference. In fact, it did take away a little bit from the momentum of the conference, and if I had to choose, I would have taken it out. But it didn't ruin the fucking conference like so many people seem to be saying. That's silliness to say that. And yes, Yamashoto has a good point. E3 is technically for the press, not always for gamers, despite the fact that we've kind of made it our thing. It's not exactly just for gamers themselves and the audience. It's for the press, and it's not the Electronic Gaming Expo. It's the Electronic Entertainment Expo. You have to remember that as well. We're lucky that we see as much as we do with as little as we do about television each year. So anyways, I'm interested to see if Nintendo can live up to what Sony put on yesterday. It's gonna be hard to top that, especially in 47 minutes. I understand that Nintendo plans to do more than just this 47 minute bit. Can you guys refresh me? How are they doing this again? They're like doing this 47 minute bit, but then in like an hour they're doing a treehouse thing where they talk in more detail or something like that, and then they're having... I don't think I'm watching the Smash thing, because as soon as this is done, I have to start collecting trailers and getting ready for tonight's show where the gang shows up and we all watch the trailers together. The treehouse stuff is going to be boring. I know that they are going to be streaming from the treehouse for the entire E3. Thanks, K-Shade. I'll check that out later on. The treehouse isn't going to cover anything new. The only time treehouse is going to have something new is, I think, their first segment involves Miyamoto or something like that, isn't it? And he comes and he'll be showing off his new games in more detail. But besides that, there's nothing really special happening on the treehouse. It's just going to be developer interviews all week. There might be some interesting things that happen every so often, but they're streaming 20 hours of gameplay. 20 hours of gameplay doesn't mean that there's going to be a lot of new games to show off. It could just mean 20 hours of one game. It won't be 20 hours of one game. But I don't have any faith in the treehouse. I don't think there's going to be anything really special and new. You're gonna see like probably some gameplay of a little bit of Smash Bros, but I bet you're gonna see a whole bunch of Mario Kart. I seriously think you'll see them stream Mario Kart a lot. And then there's Electronic Arts. I'm just summarizing everything we've seen so far. Electronic Arts, I would be happy if Electronic Arts stopped showing up to E3 for press conferences. It's just it's a big gap in the day that nobody gives a shit about. Unless they start covering more of, I guess it's because they're so far in between the IPs that aren't sports right now. Like, they're so far away from the next Mass Effect. And I mean, it's weird though, because Dragon Age is coming out this year, and yet they dedicated like 10 seconds at the fucking start of the conference to Dragon Age. You'd think that would have been a big major concentration in the middle of their conference, but it wasn't. It was just that little tiny snippet of music. Oh, there's music on the stream? I'll listen to it now. Let's see what we got here. What kind of music is it? I better do an announcement, I suppose. Hey buddies, here we are, the first day, technically, of E3. It kicks off with Nintendo's press conference, or digital event. They're not getting on the stage, but they're releasing a video for us to see, pre-recorded, what they have in store. New games. Old games? I don't... See you there. First try every time. Perfection. And that's important to remember, guys. I dock Nintendo points for not getting up on stage. I'm sure some of you disagree with that. Part of my excitement about E3 is that anything can happen on stage. Sometimes people get up there and they're really awkward. Sometimes things are said, something slips, something funny happens. That's part of my excitement about E3, and I don't like that Nintendo's taken that away. You should be excited about that too. I mean, some of our most favorite memes come from that. My body is Reggie. My body is ready. Would have never happened if they had only done digital streams from the beginning. Without people getting up on stage, you're never gonna have that kind of thing again. You're never gonna see those silly little things that nobody intended to say happen again. That sucks. Alright. Another thing that I am... Thanks, I'll pixelate Twitch now. A reminder for the viewers on Twitch, in order to watch the stream, you need to go to multi-Twitch. I think that people have probably set up links for you already down there. If you don't want to use multi-Twitch, it might even be better to open up two windows and have Nintendo's YouTube stream in one window and me in the other, because you can pause the Nintendo stream on YouTube if it gets out of sync and you want to get it more into sync. Usually, because of the pixelated screen, you're going to be able to tell where I am in the video generally, just based on the colors that are showing up in the pixels. But that is all you're going to see. And that is because I asked for permission and didn't receive any replies from Twitch. I asked multiple people at Twitch for permission to restream the broadcasts in this format, just like I do every year, and they wouldn't give it to me. So they wouldn't even give me a reply. So unfortunately, that's what we have to live with this year. It sucks, but oh well. I am still surprised by how many people watch despite this kind of bullshit, and I thank you guys for turning out to hang out with me and watch E3. It makes it so much more exciting when thousands of people are hanging out with me and watching it as it comes out live, reacting to everything that happens. I can't seem to get the Twitch chat to refresh. I can't see anything anybody's saying in there. Whoa. There we go. I was just reminded of another great E3 moment on stage with Nintendo in one of the very early E3s at the debut of the... It was towards the end of the GameCube's life, the year before the Wii was released. and they debuted Skyward Sword, and Miyamoto came out on stage with a shield and a sword, replica of the Master Sword and Master Shield, and stood there on stage grinning like he was 10 years old, and people in the audience just going fucking ape shit for him. And there was just so much love being poured onto that stage for Miyamoto, the creator of Zelda and Mario, and that was just one of the best, greatest moments, not only of E3, but in gaming in general. It was a great moment in gaming, and I hate that it really sucks that Nintendo has kind of spurned that past, that tradition of going up on stage. Because that's where that, moments like that will never be possible again, so long as they never get back up on stage again. So you'll understand me why I dock points for any company who doesn't get up on stage. I hope that you'll understand that logic behind that. It's not because I am going in with a pessimistic view. In fact, I'm going in with sort of a romantic view of what a conference at E3 should be like. I don't want to dock them points. I don't want to. Everybody knows that if anything, I skirt dangerously with territory of being a Nintendo fanboy more than anything. It's funny that for every person who calls me a fanboy for one company, there will be just as many people who say that I'm a fanboy for the opposite. Or say that I'm going in with unnecessary hatred for the company that I am apparently a fanboy of to other people, you know? People cherry pick what they decide that I am biased towards. It all depends on whether it supports their opinion or not. I wonder where these tunes come from. At the very least, they're not licensed, so that's nice. Doesn't sound like they're licensed. Do you want me to unpixelate so that you can match up your time code, guys? Here you go. Match that time code up and you'll be in sync. I'll leave the time code up until the conference starts. I should probably go full screen. Hey, this actually sounds like it might be licensed, doesn't it? Does anybody recognize this tune? It doesn't sound like something I can stream. I'm turning it down. By the way, Twitch chat, you also can't hear the conference through the screen. That makes it easier for you to listen to your own copy of the conference separate. People always say I'm 40 seconds behind. I'm not 40 seconds behind. You're 40 seconds behind me, because Twitch has decided that it makes sense for an interactive streaming service to be 40 seconds behind its audience, or for the audience to be 40 seconds behind the streamer that interacts with them. I don't know where they got that idea from. Infrastructure problems. I really should have Mountain Dew and Doritos on E3 day. Super Smash Bros. Smash Fest at Best Buy. Go hands-on with the Super Smash Bros. Smash Fest. Today's digital event will provide updates on Nintendo's upcoming projects, including new game announcements. Ugh. On a positive note, well, I mean, not that I was on a negative note before, but last night I can tell you that I watched that new Dead Island 2 trailer like 3 times in a row. Fucking love that trailer. It's so good. It's probably my favorite trailer of the entire conference so far. I can't think of one that I like better. Yeah, it's the best trailer. It's so perfect. It's Aaron. So Aaron, everybody keeps on saying Aaron Paul. So who was Aaron Paul? Was he the guy's voice that grabbed the after he grabbed the shoes? Oh, it won't live up to the hype. I mean, come on, it's Dead Island, right? But I still doesn't mean I can't get excited about a trailer. It's a fucking awesome trailer. It was so awesome. Oh god, it sounds like the garbage guys are showing up right now. So you're gonna be hearing clanking and clamoring on the mic for the next, like, 10 minutes. Because they're, like, right outside my garage door. Sunset Overdrive trailer was really good, and I liked that it kind of poked fun at the video game industry. I thought it was cute, especially during a Microsoft press conference, of all things. To make fun of the cover system at a Microsoft press conference, that's hilarious. And the Dead Rising DLC trailer was funny, but still, none of them really compared to, like, the story and the cinematic aspect of the Dead Rising trailer. Like, all of those were very clearly video game trailers, whereas the Dead Island trailer is funny no matter what. Whether it's a video game trailer or not, it's just a great little piece of cinema. Like, it's a nice little short film, if you want to call it that. You wouldn't even have to want to play the video game and you can still enjoy that thing. Whereas the other stuff, like, really, they're selling video games with the other stuff. With this, it's just, I don't know. It was just really cool. I loved it. Magic was cute. Yeah, it was funny. I sneeze again. I've been sneezing all morning. God damn it. Alright, let's turn up the music again. So did anybody say they recognize this song? It was Deadmau5? Really? Holy shit. Nintendo playing Deadmau5? That's really weird. It doesn't seem to mesh well. Oh, here we go. First trailer. Nope. Just the intro video.
Nintendo Digital Event.
Nintendo President and COO Reggie Fils.
They got Decime. Robot if you say chicken. So.
Welcome to E3, Nintendo fans. And you guys thought we wouldn't have a press conference. Not my problem. We have Nintendo's biggest stars backstage, ready to make some big announcements.
Oh, great! Another Mario game!
Don't love your tone, but actually no new Mario game today.
What? I'm getting bombed? Bring my cart around! I'm out of here!
Hey, looks like I'm the new face of Nintendo.
Hey, they promised me you wouldn't be here! Come on, Reggie, give us Mother 3!
How about this instead?
Hey, wait a minute! Oh, man, a man! Heroes are backstage! Died. Who's watching the bad guys?
Not my problem.
It's me, Wario!
I guess this is my problem. While I go Reggie on these fools, here's what's new.
Oh, I have to pixelate. Sorry, Twitch. Pixelated. Wow. What the fuck is going on? Confirmed, Reggie and Iwata are new competitors in Smash Brothers. I think that's as good a confirmation as ever, isn't it? Stone cold. That face. Oh, it's a confirmed Reggie. Wait, they're just confirming that you can fight as your me. I called this a long time ago, that you'd be able to fight as your me. And a lot of people said that it wouldn't happen. I don't know why, but a lot of people said it would. I forget what people's reasonings for disagreeing with me were on that. Oh, shit. Was anybody expecting the toys to integrate with Smash Bros? This might be actually a bad thing, guys. I don't want to, like, rain on your parade, but... Nintendo wouldn't force you to buy the toys, would they?
Hello, I'm Masahiro Sakurai from Sora Limited. Here at the Nintendo Digital event, I'd like to lead off by talking about Super Smash Bros.
What if you have to buy them?
Right now, you're seeing two familiar bigwigs facing off in a friendly battle. But this isn't a simple pre-rendered animation. What you are seeing will be possible in the new Smash Bros. Games. Now, by using a Mii fighter, anyone can join the battle.
Sweet. That's
I thought about
be
having
fun.
Mii characters appear in Super Smash Bros. Brawl, but in the end decided against it. Somehow at the time, it didn't seem right to have Miis punching and kicking. For this game, though, we're not simply throwing the Miis into the fray.
Brawl.
We've done some serious work getting them ready for a fight. Have a look. They're almost not even Miis anymore.
So what's the purpose of the toy? If you don't have to buy them to use the character, why use the toy at all, is the question. Wow, Miis look like they might be the best character. They look like they can be any character. It looks as though you can customize and choose your own moveset. Like, wasn't that move?
I think you can tell that the Miis are going to be just as competitive as the other characters. Mii fighters will come in three varieties. Brawlers fight empty-handed and prefer to be up close and personal. Mii brawlers are both fast and powerful.
Oh, okay, so you have classes.
Sword fighters are weapon masters. They stay cool and calm as they chase down opponents. Gunners are armed with mysterious arm cannons. They have lots of different projectiles that can be fired from long.
Uh-oh, my stream's buffering. Sorry, we might end up out of sync, Twitch viewers.
Brawlers, sword fighters, and gunners. Each type is treated as a separate fighter.
I'm gonna be a
gunner. And each type can choose four special moves from 12 options.
More buffering, which doesn't make any sense. I'm stuck on the image of the soaring axe kick. Still buffering. Is anybody else buffering? Fuck you, Twitch Monkey. I hope that's a joke. I'm going to refresh the page. I don't know if that's a good idea, even. I'm going to go directly to YouTube. Wow, what the fuck? My internet connection? No. This actually might be my internet connection right now. All right, I'm trying to get this to work. No, that... What the fuck's going on? That wasn't my internet connection. It is Nintendo, or YouTube. Let me try to get this back up. Here we go. Pick it up from where I left off.
This means that the Mii fighters will have a total of 36 special moves from which to choose. It would take 9 regular fighters to equal that.
I'll unscramble for a moment for Twitch if you want to try to match up with me.
But I didn't decide to include Miis in the lineup just so you or your friends could join the battle.
Lincoln.
See, every day, I receive requests for new characters to be added
Elijah
to the
Wood.
And now you
like
can use
battle.
Miis to recreate any character you like and fight as
Ice T pours it on.
You can
right,
fight.
Scrambling
Anyone
again.
Can fight. This is your chance to defeat Nintendo's greats.
It wasn't my internet problem. I just accidentally clicked a button when
We're
I was
fast
trying
approaching
to...
the sales date of the 3DS
Oh, I scrambled
version.
Turbo. Whoops.
The game is almost
complete. There you go, Twitch.
But of course, there are an astronomical number of variables in a game like this. We have to be sure to put enough people on the debug team and test it correctly. Thank you for your patience. We've put all our focus into getting the fighters,
I'll
items,
scramble again
assist
in a moment
trophies,
after you've
stages,
up.
And enemy characters ready and in the game. And there are many different modes besides the main Smash battles. I won't go over them in detail now, but let me show you a bit of what's in store for you.
And... scrambled again. So we're looking at the 3DS version of Smash Bros, which almost looked like an overworld Mario Party map for a moment there. I guess this is the subspace emissary, like this is the campaign mode type of thing going on. Customizable matches, assist trophies. Oh yeah, we keep on seeing more about these customizable movesets. That's gonna add a huge amount of complexity to matches.
There are many more game elements that we haven't introduced yet, but I don't think we can talk about them all before we release. However, this will be our first Smash Bros. Game on a handheld, so I hope you're all looking forward to Super Smash Bros. For Nintendo 3DS.
Twitch viewers, the date just popped up. And the Wii U logo, and the holiday date.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Nintendo's digital event at E3. This year, we wanted to do something different to celebrate what it means to be a Nintendo fan. Today, you'll meet many of the talented Nintendo teams working hard to deliver great games and hear some of our big E3 news, with more to be shared throughout the show. While I've changed out of my Fireflower suit for now, Mario is still close to my heart.
Yeah, explain
you
this shit.
You may recognize this as what Mr. Iwata used earlier to defeat my Mii Fighter in Super Smash Bros. Now, I'll say there's no way he beats me without resorting to a little magic. And in fact, I'm right. That's exactly what he did. Because this is no ordinary toy. This is one of the first in a new line of products Nintendo has in development called Amiibo. And only on Nintendo systems will you be able to enjoy all the
Amiibo.
Different experiences in this Toys
Hashtag
to Life catalog.
Amiibo.
Along with Amiibo, both Disney Infinity and Skylanders Trap Team have unique features and functionality that can only be found on Wii U.
They just
There's a special chip
confirm that Nintendo's going to be a part
figure.
Of Skylanders.
Any Wii U system will recognize the figures by touching them on the Wii U gamepad. And when that happens, they spring to life in compatible games in cool new ways.
So
when you touch Amiibo to the gamepad, the character's data is downloaded into the game.
Mario can show up in Skylanders.
And it's also a two-way street.
I'm pretty sure that's what he was insinuating.
Back to the figure. So in other words, your figure's data changes as you play, which opens the door for various new gameplay possibilities. For example, your own figure with its own unique stats and fighting style will not only appear, but also evolve as a fighter in Super Smash Bros. On Wii U. In fact, Super Smash Bros. For Wii U will indeed be the first game to support amiibo. In other words, this holiday, we're not only releasing the game
we need way more detail on this,
but also amiibo that literally gives you new ways to play. As you saw in my battle with Mr. Iwata, when you use an amiibo in Super Smash Bros. For Wii U,
it lets you win.
That character will appear as a fighter in the game and compete in battles, developing its own unique attributes and skills.
I wonder if the pro scene will allow this.
Have them score off against other amiibo. They can even join you and fight on the same team. But Super Smash Bros. Is just the start. Amiibo play is also being prepared right now for a number of other Nintendo games. One of those is a game many of you are already playing, Mario Kart 8.
This sounds dangerously like pay to win.
Other games soon.
I don't know how else to interpret this.
I'm guessing you've got a lot of questions, but there's much more to cover in this digital event today. So I'm going to ask you to do this. When we're done here, at any time you can catch Nintendo of America's own Bill Trinan, who's hosting a dedicated amiibo video that goes into a little more detail. So be sure to find him at Nintendo.com or the Nintendo YouTube channel.
I'm not about to call the apocalypse, but I would say that some people
Super
should
Smash
at least be
Brothers
a little bit worried where they're going
are
with
big
this.
Big initiatives for Nintendo. But now it's time to give you a sneak peek at some of the many projects in development. Whenever I'm over in Japan and lucky enough to see these new games, I'm reminded of the first video game I fell in love with, Super Mario World on my Super NES. I played it endlessly, finished with 99 lives, and I still have that cartridge.
Everybody finished with 99 lives.
The first game you fell in love with, too. Those of us who play games know that there's nothing quite like them in the world. And those of us who love Nintendo know that no matter what's going on in our lives, we can always count on these games to deliver fun and great gameplay.
Wow, Reggie's getting all sentimental.
It's Nintendo.
That
but
slow
what is
zoom.
It like to make these games? Well, you're about to find out directly from our development teams. They're working on some amazing new projects that underscore the point that there's never been a better time to play games on Nintendo platforms. At the end of the day, Nintendo game creators share one belief: there's nothing wrong with having a little fun. With that, I'm going to step aside to let our developers show you their new games. Enjoy the rest of the
Hurry
show.
Up! Hurry up! Yarn. Kirby? Kirby's Epic? Wait, yeah, we haven't seen one since. Oh, wait. They've got the new Yoshi game in Yarn, and there's the green Yarn. Yeah, this is gonna be about the Yoshi Yarn
game. I'm Tezuka
game.
Of Nintendo. How do you do?
I'm Ebisu of the Goodfeel Company. Thanks for having me.
What are you doing in my yarn shop?
When Nintendo reached out to Goodfeel,
who are you?
We didn't ask them to make Yoshi's Woolly World as a sequel to Kirby's Epic
Yarn. Oh, wow, this looks beautiful.
We said we wanted to make
this
a
looks
Yoshi
good.
Game.
Oh, it looks gorgeous.
But we asked them to use the yarn and fabric as materials for creating new gameplay mechanics.
Oh, that depth of field.
To create a new kind of Yoshi game filled with those kinds of elements.
It's pretty. Oh my Christ.
For Kirby, we used strands of yarn as the core element and expressed things through their movement. This time, now that we were working in a three-dimensional
world, his nose squishes.
The challenge was
his
that
eggs are made of yarn.
Wasn't going to be visually impressive. So how do you play with a pile of yarn? Or some cloth. We thought about those things.
Fuck off with your fucking buffering today.
things pretty hard.
They get unraveled and knitted up and do a lot of things like that.
I'll unscramble Both Twitch Mario again so you can sync if you want.
2D action platformer games. The big difference is that Mario games are about performing challenging tasks within a given time limit. But with Yoshi games, they don't have any time limits. So you're able to freely explore the vast game world.
Yoshi just unleashed the chain chomp on my screen. I'm going to scramble it again in a moment.
It's turning out to be an action game where you can have fun in a wide variety of ways.
And scrambling.
When you usually make an action game, things like how far you can jump are set at a certain distance. So you would build the terrain with that in mind. But in the case of Yoshi, he's so almighty. If he tries, he can fly as far as he wants. His tongue is the most powerful weapon. Well, it may be weird calling it a weapon.
Oh, is that red shell a button?
So, as we were thinking about how we should build the game, Tezuka-san told us that it's centered around exploration. We took it as Yoshi's abilities are there to be utilized for exploration. From there, we were able to progress with the game's development smoothly.
By using yarn, there are new ways to explore.
There are a lot of transformations in the game because Yoshi himself is made of yarn.
Turbos, if you're watching ahead of the stream,
so this time,
don't fucking say a thing in the chat. Mode. Like, what are you thinking?
Two Yoshis appear, and that actually plays really well. Two people can play to help each other out. So in tough situations, if there are two players, they can both overcome it. Yoshi can eat up and spit out the other Yoshi wherever he likes. This is really important in co-op.
Oh my god, Yoshi's eating Yoshis? Cats and dogs living together.
Really, a wide range of gameplay is possible. We've made prototypes of different ways to express the yarn fabric for Yoshi. And we felt that the stuffed yarn Yoshi was particularly attractive. There was quite a phase of trial and error until we decided to go with the current form.
Why are they? This time it's about a textured look, and we also wanted to give the world a handmade feel. But we then asked, what makes things look handmade? We tried making things of our own, hoping that it would help in reflecting the handmade feel to the game.
Please tell me they actually took crocheting lessons.
There is certainly a key phrase that I have. It's amazing Yoshi.
I really want an old lady to show up at the end and ask them, please get out of my yarn shop.
I want to make it a game that brings a smile to your face just by owning it.
Well, that's quite adorable. Maybe a little too adorable. Yoshi's Woolly World.
Here you go!
Toad? No, he is not getting his own game. Fuck you, Toad. Oh, it's gonna be DLC for Mario 3D World. Pretty decent. He's quite the little adventurer. Captain Toad Treasure Tra- Oh wow, is this a full-fledged retail release? Is this a full-on game, or is it going to be DLC?
Oh! Hello!
Hello.
Hey, look, I'm really sorry
about
kidnapping you 80-plus times, but my bad.
Nintendo embracing
robot
chicken.
So is it cool if I have the last donut? I deserve that.
Oh my Christ.
Last year, I said that revisiting the conventions of the Zelda series would be our theme for the new Zelda game for Wii U. However, before I get into that, let me talk about something that I needed to help to realize this ambition. In fact, it's something that we've wanted to do for a long time in the Legend of Zelda series, and so development began with this as our focus. In the earlier releases of the Legend of Zelda games, players got to explore a wide area, scrolling up, down, left, and right.
Uh-huh.
However, after the game transitioned to 3D and the hardware continued to evolve, it became harder to create that feel of being in a vast world. For example, in Wind Waker, we used various techniques to create a wide world where you could freely explore many isolated islands. But it was very hard to create one large world where everything felt connected. We had to design small, bounded areas with a defined entrance and exit. And putting them all together made it feel like you were playing in a large world. But you still couldn't cut through the boundaries wherever you liked to explore that world. Today, I'd like to talk to everyone about the latest Zelda game for Wii U.
Yeah.
But first, please take a look at how the game looks on screen.
Fucking talk about it! What? Oh!
This is the new world of Zelda. It's quite a vast world, isn't it?
I want to see what Link looks like.
You can even reach those mountains in the distance if you walk far enough. We couldn't create such a wide world like this in the past. As far as what you can do with such a vast field to explore, as soon as those boundaries are removed, it means you can enter any area from any direction.
Let me see Link!
So the puzzle solving in this game begins the moment the player starts to think about where they want to go, how they will get there, and what they will do when they arrive. This is a clean break from the conventions of past games in the Zelda series, where you had to follow a set path and play through the scenario in the right order.
So,
I believe this departure will create opportunities for new gameplay that have not been experienced
in
previous Zelda
games. You don't have to do anything in order? Like, it's going to be
as you can see,
completely open world?
And as you know from the Zelda series, the world in these games can be quite peaceful. However, it is a Zelda game after all, so strong enemies will certainly appear, even in this setting. Powerful enemies appearing in such a peaceful world is one of the defining features of the Zelda series.
I think that one convention we can keep, right?
Lasers! Fucking robots! Oh my god, nice reveal! Showmanship! Wow, Link looks even sexier than before. He's getting more and more feminine all the time. I'm not against it.
Looks pretty beautiful to me.
I'm just gonna rewrite it in my head that Link's a girl, and that way I'll just get a crush on Link. And that's cool. So it's kind of a, it looks like, to me, sort of a combination between Wind Waker and Skyward Sword. Like, it was a little bit, more... Pokemon! Is this the re-release of Ruby and stuff? Yeah? All right, so I'm not too interested in the remakes or the new games. But anyways, about Zelda, it seemed kind of like Skyward Sword, but a little bit more cartoony than Skyward Sword. But at the same time, a little less cartoony somehow. I don't know, like it was actually more like a Wind Waker combined with Twilight Princess or something style of it. It's really hard to gauge what it was.
Do you ever take those gloves off?
No! Take my gloves off, do whatever I want.
Oh, here we go. Okay, now.
Shut up!
Dead witches get dragged to hell. It is what it is.
Little bit of Bayonetta now.
These are the gates. Whatever your friend did to get on the other side of these, let's just say she's not having a good day.
That wasn't supposed to be Bayonetta's voice.
Welcome to hell, love.
Oh my god, her...
one for pets who don't listen to their master.
Her voice is a bit different or weird. Like, something's off about it. Anybody else notice that?
You know, love, you're probably the only person on the planet who says, go to hell, and means take me there.
I'm afraid I don't have time to dance too long. A friend is waiting for me.
Time's almost up. Bayonetta, you better start creating miracles.
It sounds really weird. It's just way
you
different.
You can go another round, can't you?
Oh my god, she's gonna cosplay.
Fuck off. Featherface.
Bayonetta is going to cosplay in the new Bayonetta game. Bayonetta cosplaying as Samus and Link.
I'm the general producer of Hyrule Warriors, Koinuma of Koei Tecmo.
I'm the development producer of Hyrule Warriors, Hayashi of Koei Tecmo.
I'm Anuma of Nintendo, supervisor.
There are a lot of us in the Hyrule Warriors development team who grew up playing The Legend of Zelda. So getting the chance to work on this series, we were actually a little nervous.
But Anuma-san told us we could do whatever we like a number of times, and it became the action style that it is now.
A big difference between this and the Zelda games is that you're fighting an army, and there are multiple battles occurring on the field at once. If your forces are in trouble,
oh, you can play,
you get a warning, so you have the option to go out there
Midna
and help out your allies.
What I think is great with the Zelda world is how giant bosses appear, and you have to think about how to beat them. I think those things are what makes the essence of Zelda, which I think will be a new discovery for fans of the Dynasty Warriors series.
There's also a two-player mode.
You can play two players by using both TV and gamepad. It's not a split-screen experience, so you're able to each be fully immersed on a single screen.
That's interesting. How about two systems? Do you need to use the...
There are a lot of playable characters. But you know, since it's The Legend of Zelda, there are Link and Princess Zelda. Impa.
Wow, that's the biggest tits I've ever seen Zelda have. Ever. Like, by far. Like, that's three times the size they have ever been before.
A playable character. If there is a certain character you like in the series, this is the first game where you'll be able to play as your favorite character.
There are a lot of playable characters in the Dynasty Warrior series. But man, the ideas they come up with for what kind of moves they give the characters are amazing. They really think of amazing things.
I'm really surprised that Nintendo's allowing the over-sexualization of Zelda.
So now, it's really turning out as a great new Zelda collaboration.
I thought that they would more closely protect that IP.
Hyrule Warriors.
Since this collaboration was a first of its kind, we were able to make it a great game that's like a celebration of both franchises.
It seems that they're pretty
faithful
to Midna and Impa.
I really hope you all look forward to it.
As a collaborative title, it has both the essence of Zelda and the essence of Dynasty Warriors, as well as a lot of other essences they have all mixed in to form a brand new experience. It'll be great if both fans get interested in playing the other series. It'll make me really happy if they all have fun playing.
Midna doesn't need boobs. Midna's got them hips. And she always has.
Kirby Clay!
So, Kirby's gonna be Play-Doh now. So Yoshi gets his yarn. So I guess we can confirm 2018 Clay Yoshi? This looks neat. This looks as though it's exclusively played on the gamepad. Like, how do you play this on the TV if you need to be drawing constantly on the gamepad? Oh, yeah. Kirby and the Rainbow Curse, 2015. Elma, what could this be? Oh, this thing. I still don't know what to think of this thing. Monolith Soft. It's the cross X whatever thing, right? X? They're just calling it X? How can you just call something X? Name in progress. Melodrama! Okay, so it's going to be called Xenoblade Chronicles. What the fuck was that?
Maybe now you reconsider announcing Mario Ballet. What about Star Fox?
Ah, this was rumored, right? That looks really cool. That looks neat. Oh my god, they brought back the hands from fucking Mario Paint! Oh, this is... I think this is, in a way, a revival of Mario Paint. To some extent, maybe. They've got the dog down there. They're reusing the dog from Mario Paint. So this is kind of like... What? You can export it and play it in New Super Mario Bros? Look at that! It lets you swap between the two, just like that! Oh my god, this is gonna be huge! This is intense. Create your own custom Mario courses. I can't believe the doggy from Mario Paint's back. That's so cool. Impossible levels. What do we got here? This looks like new IP. Is this still... Okay, Splatoon.
Hi, I'm Nogami, the producer of Splatoon.
I'm Amano, Splatoon. One of the game's directors.
And I'm the other director, Sakaguchi.
Splatoon is an 8-player, 4-on-4, online multiplayer action game. It's all about controlling territory. Teams
Holy
battle
shit.
To claim their turf by splattering the map with ink, and the team with the most territory, when time runs out, wins.
It's Nogami like the Blob.
Actually came up with the squid idea. One day, out of the blue, he was like, hey, let's make them squids.
The Blob versus
Rather than designing mode. The characters and then making a game around that, we instead came up with the game first and then created characters we thought would work well with the gameplay. That's actually how Nintendo prefers to approach game design.
One day when Sakaguchi-san and I were hanging out on our day off, he said, hey, what if you're able to switch between being a squid and a person? For example, say you can only shoot ink as a person, but as a squid, you're able to perform a wider range of actions. With that as our main concept, we thought about different ways to expand the gameplay, and the squid idea meshed perfectly.
This looks
we
really
thought of
neat.
Things like, what if you can swim really fast in your own ink as a squid? Or what if your feet get stuck when walking through enemy ink?
Wow, yeah. This...
Through this process, we kept expanding the game's features, which brought us to where we're at now, with players able to do things like ink and swim up walls and swim super fast through their own ink.
As a person, your first priority is shooting ink to expand your territory. Once you've done
the amount of strategy in this is probably
so deep. You've got
more turf to
move and make use of your squid abilities.
When you're using the gamepad, you can quickly look up.
Can you shoot other people?
Or tilt your gaze downward to aim. It's really natural and intuitive.
Yep.
I think these controls are a great use
you
of
can.
The gamepad's gyro sensor.
This is their way of bringing a family-friendly
also displayed on the gamepad.
And
you can check
it
to see what colors of ink are being splattered where in real time. This really lets you keep an eye on how the battle is unfolding.
The most family-friendly shooter game.
You only get moment-to-moment glimpses of the action. But because of the layering nature of splattering the ground with ink, you can tell by glancing at the map what other players are up to and where they're headed. I think that adds a new layer of strategy to a game like this. Spices it up a bit. The other neat use of the gamepad is making use of your allies' icons displayed on the map.
So can you play split screen?
If you tap one of these icons, you'll blast off from
local
your location and land next to them ready to go. This
oh,
is just
neat.
One more mechanic that adds a nice twist to the strategy.
Good idea.
Your enemies are shooting ink as well. With regular guns, you can't really see bullets flying by. But since this is ink, you'll be able to see it flying from around a corner, and you'll know, whoa,
it has
a bad
to,
guy
right?
Over
there. It has to have local co-op.
If you forge forward and ink a path, your allies will be able to use it to follow you, and you'll be able to get to your enemy's territory quicker.
I don't think
but
Nintendo's
on the other
ever
hand,
done a game
they
where
can just
local
ink over
wasn't
that
an
and
option.
Ruin your strategy.
Wow, you really
in this
move
way,
slow
splattering
through
ink
your
is both
enemy's
an
ink.
Offensive and a defensive tool.
There are a lot of different ways to play depending on your style. Some people like to stay hidden in the ink for a long time and wait for the perfect chance to pop out. Other people just blaze ahead inking a path to try to get as far as they can into enemy territory as fast as they can. There are a lot of different tactics you can employ, but no matter how you play, the ink you're shooting has an effect on everyone else. You'll never feel like you're playing alone or in a vacuum. It's pretty magical, really. Amano-san, you like to try and ambush people, right?
Do I? Yeah, I guess so.
I play it a bit safer and lay down a lot of ink and make it hard for enemies to advance into my team's territory. I like to stay at home and protect the base.
Yeah, that's not my style at all.
I'm just plain bad.
Yeah, Nogami-san, you're really not very good.
I love that. You're really not very good. It's really surprising how not Nintendo it looks. Despite it being colorful, I suppose I'm just impressed that Nintendo's not using Nintendo characters. You would expect them to, right? With something like this. But they've created entirely new characters for the first time in a long time, it feels like. Outside of the Mario universe. Like, if you told me this was another company, not Nintendo at all, I would believe it, and I wouldn't expect it to be that popular, actually, if it was by another company, unfortunately. I'm not completely in love with the characters, either. Like, I don't want to be too negative, but, like, I think kids will love them. But I think they kind of look a little bit cheap, like 1993 3D animation.
Well, that just about, you know what I'm saying? Like that cheap stuff. Nintendo Digital Event. But at the same time, it's just the beginning of your continuous contact with Nintendo at the show this year. First of all, right after we sign off, we invite you to stay tuned on Nintendo's Twitch channel for our post-show recap, Nintendo Minute Live at E3. There's even more game news we didn't have time to squeeze into this video.
Is that the first time that Nintendo has officially mentioned Twitch?
Come on down to the Super Smash Brothers Invitational.
That kind of makes me nervous.
It's a one-of-a-kind tournament.
Nintendo getting buddy-buddy with Twitch.
To see as much Super Smash Brothers live action as you could ever want. You'll find more details at e3.nintendo.com/invitational. But Nintendo's experience at E3 is also spreading across the country, thanks to our partnership with Best Buy. You'll find more details at BestBuy.com.
Have they done anything with their Twitch Smashfest channel yet?
And if you want to just follow along
Have they ever done anything on Twitch before this?
Our coverage is going to be nonstop. We're going to be broadcasting Nintendo Treehouse live at E3 from the show floor directly on Nintendo's Twitch channel.
If you Based on what games, I've seen so far, Nintendo did not beat Sony.
Many of the people who created
Sony just
games,
had so much more to show.
Is binge heaven.
And so many and surprising, yes, like, holy fuck moments.
Follow us on our Twitch and YouTube channels. Get more information.
The Zelda preview was definitely satisfying, though.
On Facebook and
it
Twitter
was nice to see a new
and
Zelda.
Join the Miiverse E3 community. We've covered a lot of ground today, so I want to thank you for watching. But I just can't leave you without one more little teaser. Enjoy E3 and play Nintendo.
Oh, here we go. One more. You're going to show us maybe a new competitor? Ooh, who's this?
This fighter from Hyrule is quite impressive indeed. For a mere mortal.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Just fucking kill him, Link! Kill the little fucker! Don't take that shit from him. Yeah, you're going down, you little bitch! Disembowel. That little piece of shit. Oh, what? Who saved him? Oh, mommy came or something? Is this your mom now?
Lizzie Valentina? Oh, I'm not here to save you, kid.
I'm here to... Oh, wow. They really just... Really... Gave her an ass shot there. Who the hell's Platoona?
I'm here for a little
Divine intervention.
Was that supposed to be Link's
you
foot?
You want to fight too, Lady Palutena?
I'm no stranger to fighting. Have you forgotten that time we fought each other?
Well, yeah, sure. But that was when the Chaos Skin had you.
Lady Placenta.
Well, anything an angel can do, a goddess can do better. Perhaps you'd like to see some of the powers I once used to protect you. Heavenly Light.
She's a goddess from Kid Icarus.
Rocket jump. Reflect. Auto reticle.
Was anybody else expecting Lady, or expecting Link and Kid Icarus to kiss each other?
Lightweight.
They seemed to get kind of close at one point.
Mega laser.
They looked at each other's eyes.
You don't have to prove anything to me, Lady Palutena.
God, you are such a bitch.
Many worthy foes have gathered here, and I won't hold back on anyone.
That might have been the least interesting character I could have seen them debut for Smash Bros.
Dark Pit, you just dropped in to crash my party?
Dark Pit? Oh, she's so, it's so dark and mysterious.
What the fuck? There's a fucking Dark Pit? Since when? When did that happen? Oh my god. Eh, Miyamoto!
Miyamoto desu. こんにちは。あのね、今ゲームパッドとテレビを使った新しいゲームをいっぱい作ってます。これはね、とても新しい体験のゲームがたくさんできたんですけども、今度 E3 でいくつかお見せしたいと思います。ゲームパッドを使って遊んでると大きなテレビを見てる。そうすると遊んでる人以外にも周りで見てる人も楽しいんですね。でぜひとも周りで見てても楽しい新しい経験を E3 のフロアでも見ていってください。よろしく。
So that's going to be Star Fox. So confirmed, I called it. I knew that there'd be a new Star Fox. And Miyamoto's going to show it off.
Nintendo Minute Live at E3 and all aboard the E3 hype
train. Hey, it's the guys who were trying to steal my show for, Matt.
This is Krista. She's going to
be
punching
sucking while doing
and
it.
And I have officially taken this analogy way too far.
You have.
We're going to be breaking down the Nintendo Digital event today and also sharing some information that you haven't seen yet. But Krista, why don't we begin? And why don't we begin with this?
Yes. So this is the interactive figures called Amiibo. Kit has one right here. This is Mario. Yep. And we saw a little bit about this in the digital event, but there's more to talk about with Amiibo. So why don't we start off with what is different about Amiibo and what sets it apart from games like Skylanders or Disney Infinity?
So the Amiibo platform is meant to go across a number of different games. So this Mario...
it does feel like Home Shopping Network. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, it does. Oh, I can't wait to... That's a great joke.
It's really up to the developers to determine how they...
Oh, we're going to have so much fun with that tonight.
Games, so it's a very flexible platform that gives developers a lot of options.
Yeah, and we have a really cool trailer hosted by one of our favorite people ever, yes. Bill Trinan. So why don't we run that trailer now so you can see more about Amiibo.
This is so awkward. Oh my god. It keeps going. Look at all the people back there. Look at all the people working on it. They can't get figured out. Nobody knows what the fuck's going on. There's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people in the background working on computers.
Oh. Hello, everyone. I'm Bill Trinan from Nintendo's
Treehouse. Oh, Trinan.
Looks like you caught me playing with my toys. When I was a kid, I used to spend a lot of time imagining who would win when my toys got...
This is exactly why Nintendo
sometimes
should always be live.
But wouldn't it be fun if you could actually find out? Well, pretty soon you can. You see, while these may seem like regular figures, they actually hold a secret within. We're calling them Amiibo. And we're going to create Amiibo for a variety of Nintendo characters, games, and series starting later this year. When you touch these Amiibo to the Wii U gamepad controller, you will see these characters come to life in your games in many different ways. Amiibo will expand the gameplay experience of
if you guys listen very carefully,
bring about new types of fun.
You can hear them talking on their mics.
Interact with your favorite Nintendo characters. But since it's probably difficult to imagine how Amiibo will expand your experience, I'd like to show you. So let me explain using the first of many upcoming Amiibo-compatible games, Super Smash Bros. For Wii U, which will release this holiday alongside the first series of Amiibo. Now, when I talk about figures and Smash Bros., fans of the series will probably think of this.
Can't make it out.
This was the opening video from Super Smash Bros. Melee. The original concept behind this series is that figures come to life and do battle all on their own. Don't you wish you could have figures like these?
No.
Well, that wish is about to come true with Amiibo.
Oh, I don't want these figures.
Let's say you head over to a friend's house with a Link figure in tow. Your friend has a Wii Fit Trainer figure, and luckily, Super Smash Bros. For Wii U. Each figure contains the spirit of the character they represent. So, when you touch an Amiibo to the Wii U gamepad, that character will appear in the game to do battle while you cheer it on from the sidelines.
But
just like the original concept for the Smash Bros. Series.
It'll just fight.
There are many
without
different
you?
Ways to engage these characters in battle. You can pit them against other figures. You can face off against them yourself. They can team up and fight alongside you. And they may even be able to beat up your friends for you. In the game, of course. Every time your Amiibo battles, its abilities will get a small boost. Through battle, they can increase their overall level, along with their defense and attack powers. They can even learn tactics to become stronger opponents. In fact, through training, they can become quite formidable. Fighting against your Amiibo is going to be a lot more interesting than fighting against a plain old CPU opponent. Remember, even if you and a friend both buy Link figures, they won't be the same.
I still don't understand this.
You can customize their special moves based on the character's unique capabilities. That means your Link Amiibo becomes your personal version of Link that you can train and customize in ways that make it different from your friend's version of Link. You get to breathe new life into each figure as you watch them evolve and witness their personality take shape. This unique
like
data will
real
be collected
life Pokemon?
And stored inside each Amiibo. In this way, each Amiibo is your own unique figure that can act as your alter ego, partner, or rival.
Inevitably, they're going to transition this into Pokemon,
plus,
right? Like, this is what the next Pokemon will
Amiibo,
be, will be literally physical Pokemon.
CPU or human opponents. Collect your favorite figures.
I think this is like a trial run for Pokemon, instead of like,
own unique bond
they probably knew if they...
Who knows? Your Amiibo may even be able to beat that one friend you never seem to be able to take down on your own.
But that doesn't mean
when
that you beat
Super
that one
Smash
friend.
Brothers for
it
Wii
just
U
means
this
you cheated.
Winter, we plan to release several Super Smash Brothers Amiibo as well.
I think they knew that if they introduced this to Pokemon right away, there would have been backlash.
More characters on the way. So look forward to hearing
that. And this is like a trial run.
Super Smash Bros. Isn't the only game that will use Amiibo. We also plan to make games like Mario Kart 8, Mario Party 10, Captain Toad Treasure Tracker,
and
Yoshi's
Pokemon.
Woolly World.
One day. Mark my words.
Are you wondering how each of those games will interact with Amiibo?
No!
Well, each game is different. So look forward to hearing more about them in the future. We have other plans for Amiibo too. More games and figures are in the works as I speak. And one more thing. Next year, we plan to release a peripheral that will make it so you can use Amiibo on Nintendo 3DS, too. So look forward to Nintendo 3DS games that take advantage of Amiibo.
Like they weren't going to make Mario Party
Combining
10,
Amiibo
but yes,
with our games,
I guess it's interesting to see them use the word for the first time.
Experiences. It's one of the most exciting things Nintendo is debuting at E3. Stay tuned for future announcements about Amiibo. And the games that
I love Nintendo characters, and I just couldn't give a shit about this. These kids, I don't care at all, but I think kids are going to go fucking nuts for it.
Well, what'd you think? I think you will definitely be collecting all of the Amiibo figures.
I have my own personal prediction about Amiibo to share. I will own them all.
Yes, you are a hoarder, so you definitely will own them all, I'm sure. Yeah. So we talked about a ton of Wii U titles in the Nintendo Digital event, but we can't forget about Nintendo 3DS. So let's talk
Bonefoot,
about that.
Bonefoot, did
really
you just talk
right
about
now.
Yourself in the third
so
person?
So we're really excited to announce two Nintendo 3DS titles right now. Fantasy Life, will be launching on October 24th of this year from Level 5. And this is a really cool new take on an RPG where you get to play through
maybe.
The game and you get to do different jobs and you literally get to get a life.
Yeah,
so
kids really are into
Level
this shit right now.
Yeah. RPGs. And another game to talk about.
What happens when you break one? Can you still use the little...
Yes, so I'm a huge fan of Professor Layton and you guys
can
know
you still
that
use the little base
the
to
Phoenix
put your amiibo into the
these
game?
These two games are coming together
if he busts
in Professor
off of
Layton
it.
Versus Phoenix Wright Ace Attorney. And that launches also for Nintendo 3DS on August 29th. So really, really excited about those two games coming together.
And we've got more Nintendo 3DS news coming throughout the week here at E3. Later tonight, we're doing...
So how much do I have to watch today to get all of the information I need about Nintendo before I get to start working on tonight's show?
And we will be like, live tweeting that.
So I don't want to have to
at Nintendo of America, and we'll be tagging the discussion with
be constantly
Smash
checking
Brothers,
in on Nintendo
course,
for the rest of the day as I create tonight's show.
Roundtable tomorrow night, which starts at 6 p.m. Pacific, where we'll be revealing an entirely new Nintendo 3DS game that we haven't talked about before. We will also be live tweeting that, so you won't want
at
to
at 6 p.m. tonight. They're debuting a new 3DS game altogether.
More discussion about Wii U. Let's God talk really quickly about eShop. We have some really cool eShop games coming out for Nintendo 3DS and Wii U, so let's take a look at another trailer right now.
Yeah, it feels like they're being a pain. Oh, yes! Yes! I'm almost willing to watch just for these moments for the rest of the fucking week. That's looking real good to me. That's looking beautiful. Alright. Portable Space Adventures, I know that game. But these are just montages of stuff that we knew that was coming up on other systems. Probably nothing new here. So when does Miyamoto go on stage? When does he go to the treehouse to show off what he has to show off? Did anybody catch the time on it? Okay. 12:40. So, anyways, like, when it comes down to it, by separating themselves from the whole press conference onslaught of the first day, I feel like Nintendo's kind of separating themselves from the battle. They're making themselves almost a non-competitor, and I think that may be a part of their strategy. I don't think that that idea was lost on them. I think, in fact, it may have been intended from the beginning. I don't think they want to compete with the others. They want to be the system that you buy in addition to the other competitors. They want you to own a PlayStation and a Wii U. They want you to own an Xbox and a Wii U. They don't see themselves as standing up against them, and I think for that reason you're never going to see them ever do a press conference on the same day or try to compete with the other companies. It's a good thing and a bad thing in a way, to me. It detracts a lot for me from the excitement about new Nintendo announcements at E3, that's for sure. To me, that press conference, and guys, you need to judge that as a conference, as a presentation. It had its moments. It had Reggie with a wad of fighting at the beginning. It had a little bit of humor in it. Some silliness. It also had a lot of really blasé. Developer diaries can be interesting, but ultimately, hey, Citizens of Earth, we're one of the only shows to ever cover that. Developer diaries are interesting, but not really something I want to see as a part of a press conference. Press conferences, for me, I want to be just straight balls to the wall. Hype,
a cool trailer.
And then details, you know, announcements, new things, as opposed to ruminations and philosophy coming from developers, which in its own right can be interesting, but not in the context of a conference, to me.
Featured at E3, and that includes Mario, The Legend of Zelda, Yoshi. So go over to the eShop, get your I liked it. And the offer is good until
I honestly think that it probably ties with Microsoft. Maybe I'd have to think a little bit more about what Microsoft showed again.
That we wanted to tell you guys about that was not included in the digital event is
Mario Party 10. They're going to talk about
this in the video that we just saw.
Right.
But there's a lot more to this game.
Right. So Mario Party 10 is playable on our show floor, and it actually features Bowser as the star.
Right. Bowser is the star of the game. We are jokingly referring to it as Bowser Party.
Right. So it's really cool gameplay. One player plays as Bowser on the Wii U gamepad. Basically, you get to be a huge jerk to all your friends, which is something I love
to do. This is sounding really interesting.
You guys like Mario Party 10. It's going to be a cool game.
I'll be on the receiving end of your jerkiness.
Of course.
Can't wait.
Always.
And of course, as we saw in Bill's video, the game does utilize Amiibo, so that's
yes.
great.
Did you guys hear all that?
So why don't we jump into the digital event and really dig into that and talk about some of
Bowser
our
Party.
Favorites. I know we had a lot of really favorite moments throughout the video. I'll go first.
You go first.
So for me, it had to have been Splatoon. So this is a game that we...
Five-player Mario Party. Finally. Show material. Yeah. I'm really liking this trend towards five-player games. It's so perfect for our show.
First of all, how quickly people got the hang of the game and really started having fun with it. And second, just how people were able to implement the game's depth right away.
Yeah.
So the idea of the game is you're painting...
I wanted to wrap up my thoughts about the Nintendo conference. If I let nostalgia and my love of Nintendo franchises take over, it would probably give Nintendo a couple more points in my book, a little bit better, like, you know... It's still, even in that case, though, even if I let myself be completely taken up in the nostalgia and my loyalty to those franchises like Yoshi and Zelda, I still don't think that it would overtake Sony for me. And I like to judge the conferences based on showmanship as opposed to franchises. Even though it's inevitable, I can't deny that my excitement about particular franchises will end up... K-Shit, I expect a Star Fox to be a bigger part of that, too.
Their team to see you.
Right, you're like camouflaged.
So they would stay in squid form in their team's ink and wait for the other team to pass by, pop up, take them out, and then go back in.
Yeah.
So these were what Star Fox video are you guys talking about? Have they released a Star Fox video somewhere?
And I'm really excited to see what happens.
Oh, I'm tired.
Play this game more and how new tactics emerge and change over time.
Yeah, it's a ton.
They jabbed at Mother 3. I didn't see a jab at Mother 3.
We couldn't stop playing that game. So much fun. So let's move on to my personal favorite from the Nintendo Digital event, and that has to be
Yoshi. I wasn't listening. Did they talk about Mother 3?
I am such a fan of Yoshi already, and this new game world that he's knitted world.
What was it? Quote
amazing.
What
and
they said.
This might sound kind of weird, but I just want to reach into the television, like squeeze the game.
In the Robot Chicken intro?
That's a very
asked about Mother 3.
Ground, it sort of has a very
it was kind of a cynical, like making fun of the fan base for bugging them about things that they don't care about.
You know, you can do things like pull a loose yarn and
So because he said, where's Mother 3 and Star Fox, and we know that Star Fox is coming, it makes you think that maybe Mother 3 is going to be confirmed as well? That's an interesting, but if there's one thing I know as a mother, as an Earthbound fan, it's not to... Not to get my hopes up for anything. I don't speculate on any tidbits.
At E3 is to get one of those.
And we got the chance to play the game co-op.
Yes.
And I thought I was helping you out while we were playing. You seem to have a different impression of it.
No, you were hindering me. But anyways, we'll work on that some other time. But very fun. You can play the game as co-op.
They seem like such likable people.
And then, of course, something I think we both agree was a huge moment.
They're pretty good.
First look at the next game in the Legend of Zelda
correspondence
series for Wii U. Big moment for Mr. Aonuma to reveal his game.
They seem like genuine gamers
that
to me.
Where Mr. Aonuma goes, and the game pops up. Amazing. I did it. Nothing happened. Nothing's there.
Live. What?
Oh, not Hyrule. But when he did that and the world just sort of like appeared behind him. It was so beautiful, yep. You know?
And he's talked for a while about wanting to change the conventions of Zelda. Right. You can see what he's doing with this game of having this big open world. And I thought he had a great point about how it's this big open world, but he's really reinforcing some of the cores of the series with the puzzle right. solving of how even getting from point A to
So yeah, let's talk about that, guys, what they're talking about here. The whole open world Zelda. Let's be real. Most Zeldas have been open world. The only thing was that you had to do missions in order. And every open world game before that, you've always had missions to do in order. Grand Theft Auto V has a series of missions that you have to do in order, but it's still an open world game. So what does he mean by, like, it seemed like a little odd that he said that you'd be able to just, like, it seems like what he's insinuating is that you can just wander and do anything at any time and that the game has no ending or something like that. Like, how... The game's got to have a story. It's a Zelda game, right? It's got to have a fucking story. Skyrim, like, Skyrim open? That would be a little bit more open. That would be a little bit less linear. But even Skyrim was linear. It still had things that you had to do in order to get to the end of the game. You still had to go see, like, the guys on the mountain at a certain time. You still had to go fight a dragon at a certain time in Skyrim to get to the end of the story.
Happening right here, and we're doing a live stream that we've never done before. Right. This is totally new, totally groundbreaking for us. And what we're going to be doing is really going in depth on the games that everybody just saw in the digital event. So I know you guys had a ton of questions about, you know, like, what was that? What did it play like? What does it feel like? We're bringing in the Treehouse crew. These are the guys and gals who really know these games better than anyone else. They live and breathe these games. I mean, they're going to be doing live,
we're new to this,
long-form demos. We're going to be going...
Anyways, I think that in the end, you're going to find out that what he was talking about with the open-world Zelda is it's just going to be... I don't see it being any more open-world than Wind Waker. I doubt that it's going to be more open-world than Wind Waker. In fact, he used Wind Waker as a comparison constantly as, like, what he had tried to do. And the only thing he said was... The downside of Wind Waker that they had tried to achieve was that when you got to a dungeon, there was a wall and a barrier, and then there were distinct boundaries between the quest area and the open world area. So I think the only difference, really, that he's gone for with this is that instead, when you get to the dungeon, you just walk inside and it continuously, like, there's no loading, you just walk in and the quest starts unfurling before you. Instead of actually having boundaries and maps that are placed everywhere. And the same way with, like, Skyward Sword, you had to go to certain parts in Skyloft, you had to fly to a certain location, then dive through the clouds in order to get to certain locations in order to play the next quest. Whereas in this, you just walk there. You just friggin' travel there, and the quest begins wherever you arrive, as opposed to loading up a new area or a new time or you know, dungeon. I think that that's kind of more like what he was saying, but I still believe that there's going to be a story, and I think there's going to be some linear sequence of quests and side quests that you do throughout the game, even if you can, to some extent, choose the order in which they go in. I don't think that it's going to be completely as amorphous as he kind of alluded to. He made it sound like there are no quests. You just wander and do things, but I don't think that's true. Maybe I'm making more of his words than I should have, but the way he spoke really made it seem like that's what he was saying.
We're going to be having a tournament with some of the best players of Smash
from around the world.
I wasn't saying that open world meant no story shade, but it was the way that he talked about how... I can't remember his exact words, but he said things that made it sound like quests weren't going to be a thing.
I think that's
or that linear story wasn't going to be a thing.
He
kind of like, it sounded like he was saying something like that. I need to hear it again to know why I had that feeling or impression.
To get their characters?
I mean, even that is just interesting. Right. You know, and these are players that are, you know, famous for playing a particular character. Are they going to get that character? Are they not going to get that character? How are they going to adapt to the new character? The drama. And, you know, these matches are going to be absolutely amazing.
Yes.
I'm definitely going to be there and hanging out.
We'll be watching. We'll
so
be cheering.
Excited. And that will be live streamed, right here. So,
yeah.
You know, I'm really excited about that. You guys have to check it out.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, big question of what we've been discussing.
So I continue to let this stream go because I have no idea what the fuck to do right now. Like, I don't understand. Am I, like, waiting for more info right now? Am I waiting until Miyamoto goes live? I guess I am. I guess I should start working right now on tonight's show. I have lots of trailers to collect, lots of high-quality versions of all the stuff we saw from the other press conferences still. I need to learn about the games that we watched during those press conferences, learn a little bit more info about them, specific ones like the new From Software one, and I want to learn about the new Dead Island and like just details about all the games that I want to talk about tonight. So I have a lot to do. There's a Mario Party 10 trailer on YouTube, so Nintendo's just kind of like, their digital event was no real conference. It wasn't even like, it's really annoying. It's like their conference goes on for 3 days and you've got to watch fucking 8 hours a day of content in order to see everything. So I feel like the real Nintendo coverage for our show is going to come at the end of this week. We have another show planned on, like, Sunday, I think. The post-E3 show is going to wrap up everything that Nintendo ends up talking about. But they do the digital event, and then they release, like, other trailers. They don't. Why not include Mario Party 10 as a part of the digital event? Why did it have to be separately released as its own little trailer just without any pomp or circumstance on their YouTube channel? Twitch says Treehouse is live at 11:30. So the Treehouse is gone for an hour. 2 hours. An hour and a half. So one would, I guess, gather that they're going to do like three-hour segments throughout the day, like 2 3-hour segments a day or something, or 3 3-hour segments a day. Is Nintendo got something up on their YouTube, Redemption? It looks like you don't want to spoil something, but I'm going to jump to it. Let's see what they've done. Like, they've really kind of Sonic Boom, E3 trailer. They've just released everything all at once. You got Monster Hunter on here. You got, is there anything that jumps out at you guys as something crazy that's showing up here? Wii U Art Academy. Swords and Soldiers. Mario Maker. What's jumping out to you guys as something as, like, crazy? What's new? There's a bunch of stuff they released yesterday, it looks like, eh? Excuse me. Xenoblade Chronicles is one of the few things they actually did cover during the press conference. So that's not new and exciting. Persona Q is new. Mario vs. Donkey Kong, where's that? This sucks because this is my reaction. Instead of Mario vs. Donkey Kong, wow! Instead of you guys getting to see my reaction, or us all reacting together to it, we're like looking on their YouTube channel like, what's new? What do we got? What did they release? Where's this Donkey Kong thing you talked about? Wii U Mario vs. Donkey Kong E3 2014. Like, they took all the showmanship out of it. They took all the fun, I feel, by doing it like this. Like, I'm going to recreate the fun tonight, and that's what the purpose of Video Games Awesome is. Like, tonight on Show and Trailer, the crew is going to actually get to experience the hype, because I'm going to re-edit it so that it is hype-filled. It's going to be very fun to reveal it to them like that. But And yes, I know that my reaction isn't always, wow. Sometimes it's just like, meh. But I mean, at least I'm honest, right? I'm not like so many other people out there who just fucking create their reactions. Okay, this isn't actually a game. It's just, oh, what the fuck is it? Oh my god. Yeah, it's a new, what was the name of the, they did the little toy series with these guys. The Mario vs. Donkey Kong series has involved before, the toy stuff. I never really played too much with that. The March of the Minis, yeah. But it looked like it was a really interesting... It looked neat. So... I guess I'm going to start working. Like, I don't know if I'm honestly not, I don't think I'm going to go live again with Miyamoto. I think that you probably won't see me till tonight, guys. Going live with Miyamoto would just break up my day so much that I probably wouldn't, it would really probably take a chunk out of my ability to work on tonight's show. I'm probably going to be working straight from now all the way through into tonight, and you'll see my reaction, I guess, when he starts to, I'll show Miyamoto tonight on the show when he talks about stuff. But like, I can't be tuning in here every time Nintendo goes live, or I'd be just tuning in all day, sitting here all day, like, not actually working on the show that I do. Yeah, upload this to YouTube, K-Shade. Thank you. I'm gonna get myself a shower, I'm gonna get myself some lunch, and I'm gonna start editing videos. There's a Doom 4 teaser on the YouTube channel. Thank you. I'm going to, yeah. So, oh yeah, before I go, guys, you can feel free to help me throughout the day. Send me information. Send me just tweet me, I guess, is one of the better ways. Tweet me high-quality versions of the trailers that you find. I know that some people have tracked down that Uncharted trailer in high-quality for me. Somebody else found... Like, people have been finding super high-quality versions of these trailers. If you find them and they exist, send them my way. Don't tweet no BS, though, says K-Shade. Yeah, but I am interested in high-quality trailers if you're able to find them. Higher quality than YouTube, obviously. Like, specifically for those new IPs that we really want to analyze their graphics and their how they look. And if you see news and tidbits that weren't covered during the trailers, stuff that's just being covered by the journalists on the blog, stuff that might be interesting to me so that I don't have to spend all day just refreshing every single friggin' news outlet out there today. If you see stuff that you think that would be interest to me, or especially if it involves video, something that I can actually show, tweet it to me. Although, of course, I'm not going to... Somehow people always think that I'm going to be able to show interviews that were conducted by GameSpot and Game Trailers and GameSpot. Or, I mean, IGN and stuff. I can't use other outlets' stuff. I can use clips from it if something really crazy happened, like somebody slipped the tongue and, like, said something stupid or, you know... Like last year with Don Matrick or something like that. I can use clips, but I'm not gonna like fucking play whole interviews of stuff on the show. my Twitter, the best way to tweet me is at FFSTV. What else was I gonna say? And then the Konami thing. I'm really angry about Konami still. I don't know if you guys knew, but the plan today was for me to watch Konami before. I got up early to watch Konami before Nintendo, but then they just canceled. They canceled their friggin' conference altogether, except they didn't cancel it. Canceling usually means that you make an announcement that it's not going to go ahead. Instead, they just didn't do it. They just didn't cancel at all. They didn't tell anybody what they were doing. They just didn't show up. So, and I think the most annoying part out of all of that is that the major news outlets, the major media like IGN, GameSpot, Kotaku, none of them are covering that. They're not covering it. They're acting as though it never happened. Even though these same news outlets reported a week ago that they'd be doing a 3 a.m. press conference. And now they're acting like that never happened. And I've tweeted all of them asking them why they're not covering the fact that Konami just fucking shat the bed and fucked everybody over. Jim Sterling was like the only person who actually acknowledged it. Everybody else seems to not give a fuck. I think it's a story. Microsoft fucks up and we take them to task. We kick their asses and we make fun of them all fucking day. Konami fucks up and we don't? Like, they fucked up. And it's really unprofessional what they did. People got up at 3 a.m. to watch that fucking thing. I almost planned to, but instead I delayed it to watch it before Nintendo, thank goodness. And they it still fucking was a waste of my time. But then we won't get review copies, and they won't sponsor us with that big banner ad for Metal Gear Solid 5 this year. I'm just seeing if I have been responded to by any of the major media that I tweeted asking about the Konami story, but it doesn't look like it. I'm not seeing it. All right, so that wraps this up. And again, I apologize if I seem overly ranty or just annoyed. The fact is that I'm the annoyance this E3 so far for me, with some aspects of the show, has outweighed a lot of the hype and excitement. But I'll go back and I'll watch some of my favorite trailers again, and I'm sure I'm going to get very excited for tonight's show. There's a lot of good, and when you condense that good into a show, which is what my job is, you can get very hyped up. So I hope that you'll tune in tonight at 7 o'clock p.m. as we watch all the best shit from E3, all condensed into one little chunk, and we'll take all the stuff that's easy to make fun of, and we'll condense it all into one little chunk and make fun of it, and we'll have a good time, and we'll have some beers. See you later, guys. Goodbye.